This one, yeah.
That's why
Ladies and gentlemen, the judge will be coming out within the next 5 minutes, so if you could, right now, please make sure your cell phone is turned off. Thank you. And if y'all need to use your cell phone, please step back outside. Please do not use it inside the courtroom. It's just disrespectful towards the judge when he's on the bench.
If we add them into four exhibits, maybe that. I'm going from one by year, year by year.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. I like that one is all.
Yeah, that's what
I'm saying. Right, how are you?
That's all of that?
It's all of it.
And then where are the other three? Where are the other three exhibits?
It's JCATS is one, AOC is one.
Give me JCATS.
Yeah. That's okay.
You take up one for each one.
Okay. Thank you.
And then I'll introduce one, and then you give it. They are. Okay. Okay. How are you? Good to see you.
Hey.
Good to see you.
Hey.
Please make sure your cell phone's turned off, please.
Although you may be on the other side. Right.
Take care of one thing at a time.
People at that table?
How are you? Good to see you. Getting all right?
Yeah.
All these until they all in place.
Hi. How are you?
So I won't give you away if I don't stand up. Great.
Okay.
Oh, where are all our customers? You got the food stamp card. You got the food stamp. No, no, no. They can see that.
All right, I'll tell
them.
Okay.
Jordan's going to set
them
up whenever you just
okay.
Give them
the
okay. All right. Are y'all ready for the judge?
So we'll have to
ask
them to
identify
themselves. Plaintiffs? Yes, yes, thank you.
Front row.
Yes, ma'am. And one last time, please make sure yourself known for all.
Hey guys.
Hey. How are you?
I'm Amy.
Hey.
Nice to meet y'all at lunch. We're just waiting on the court reporter, and we'll be right out.
Thank you.
As soon as she's here, we'll be out.
Great.
She's putting in the pockets.
I'm looking for the exhibits. No, I need the exhibits. That's what she's doing, right?
I just got the files today, or scanned, or the ones y'all wanted.
The ones we have.
Yeah.
Okay,
great. I have them in email, and this morning I thought that, well, they scanned them, so I can just forward them to you. But originally I thought that they were more personnel files, like from yesterday. But,
right.
So I didn't send them to y'all, but we have them all scanned, and I think they're ready.
Just when you need the procedure.
Judicial Circuit is now in session. The Honorable Judge Todd Markle is presiding. Court will come to order.
Okay, y'all have a seat. I just wanted to let you know, I know Ms. Abrams came out, we were looking for a court reporter. Not sure exactly what happened, so that's the reason for the delay. But while we're waiting, is there anything we can take up off the record we want to discuss about how to handle a hearing or anything like that?
Judge, maybe just how we handle the hearing. Good morning, guys.
Sure. Good morning. It's afternoon.
We'll introduce ourselves later, I'm sure. But we have about four exhibits. We're going to offer everything else that's already before the court. I'll move those in. Everybody's agreed to everything except relevance. There may be an objection to relevance. I don't know if there is or not.
Okay.
But that'll be that. Once you approve on that, if you could give me, say, 20 minutes, half an hour to sort of present our case to go over what we've summarized and so forth. I'll do that, and then my able opponents will get up and take it on one at a time.
Okay.
About that.
Let's see, and I think I read what you submitted. Are you planning on calling witnesses?
There were no, two witnesses. We get your officers let us know that you would like to move the case. So we took everything we had and put it in either affidavits or depositions.
Okay.
Those will all be filed with the court. You've got a courtesy copy, the Chambers has a courtesy copy of all of those.
Yes.
And then we file a memorandum that's a summary of the evidence and a statement of the issues, and then the Attorney General's office on behalf of its client filed a pre-hearing brief, I think, on Monday this week.
Yes.
So those are the pleadings that you have.
Okay. Okay.
As well as some more ancient ones, but those are the most current.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank
you,
Your Honor. Alan Lightcap with the Attorney General's office. At counsel table with me is Kimberly Beal. She's also an Assistant Attorney General. We probably would only need 20 to 30 minutes to respond in mainly legal argument with some citations to the record, depending on what the plaintiff's case is. So, probably 30 minutes at most.
Okay.
Thank
All right. You. Okay. Well, we had to juggle some things around, obviously, with the weather this week, and I don't know if something was miscommunicated to the court reporters or what, but I'm going to try to round somebody up and just bear with me for a few minutes, and we'll try to get started as soon as I can get somebody. Okay, all right,
I'll be right back.
All right, thank you, sir.
I'm sorry.
What's our highest?
So we don't ever charge our clients anything. So right. Grades almost 3 million from mainly private donors. I came from a much smaller dealer, so it probably seems very different from a big firm.
Well, sure, but you guys are such a big firm.
What are you doing? You're not doing the problem?
I do mostly commercial litigation. The trademark and copyright.
The function of what's been broadcast is carried on these retransmissions. Like the NFL is broadcast because of the agreements they have with their broadcasting partners are very rarely carried in this world. But baseball is, baseball is in particular, like Cubs broadcast on WGN. So that's more detail than you probably want. But that's like part of why baseball is getting this huge chunk. Like $60 or $70 million a year.
025. Let me start over here to my right and get Mr. Bright to introduce himself and those at his table.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Stephen Bright on behalf of the plaintiffs. With me here are three lawyers from my office, although they're not out here at the moment. This is Melanie Velez, who is here with us. Atia Holly will join us momentarily, as will Crystal Red,
okay,
who are lawyers with us. This is David Gersh. He's with the firm of Arnold & Porter, who has been admitted pro hoc vice, as has Michael Kinsley, who is sitting here. So okay, those are the lawyers on behalf of the plaintiff tonight.
All right, and to my left.
Yep, thank you, Judge. I'm Assistant Attorney General Alan Lightcap. With me at counsel table is also Kimberly Beal, another lawyer at the Attorney General's office. Also at counsel table is the county defendants, and I'll let them introduce themselves.
Okay.
Your Honor, Derrick Bingham, on behalf of Crispin Wilcox County, and I hope to speak today on behalf of all of the county defendants.
All right.
And also with me, Adam.
Okay. All right. All right, any other preliminary matters before we get to the mandamus? I don't know.
You have some other lawyers here.
Yeah, let me go ahead and get you to introduce yourselves and tell me who you
are. We're not paying him to introduce his son. I'm Bert Gregory on behalf of Dula County with Bill Calhoun, who's also on behalf of Dula County.
Okay.
And Toni Sawyer on behalf of
Bingham County.
Okay.
Your Honor, Jim Hollis of Walter Bingham on behalf of the judge defendants. We've got Wright and Johnson.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. And I'm John Jones. I represent the district attorney and her assistants.
Okay. All right. Very good. All right. Mr. Bright, you got the floor.
Judge, thank you very much. And again, good afternoon. I'd like to, just as a housekeeping task, Your Honor, introduce three exhibits. As I said, everybody's agreed to stipulate only reserving any objections to the Rock. First, exhibit number 50, Your Honor, and we've numbered all the exhibits so that they run from every deposition straight through. So
all right,
stay consistent with that. Number 50 is the JGETS data over a number of years. It's a composite exhibit information from the Public Defender Standards Council, compilations of caseloads and so forth.
All right. Any objection for purposes of this hearing?
Yes, Your Honor. We would object to the relevance of past data and past statistics, being that mandamus is a prospective remedy and can only lie against the present refusal to perform public duty. So there's a lot of statistics there from 3 to 4 years ago, which we would find, we would argue, are irrelevant.
Okay. Well, I'm going to go ahead and note the objection, overrule it, and I'll consider the JCATS data for what it's worth.
Thank you, Your Honor.
And correction, Your Honor, that should be exhibit number 49.
49, okay.
Exhibit number 50 is data from the Administrative Office of the Courts. Again, it's a compilation of data,
okay,
which is a combined exhibit.
Okay. Same objection.
Same objection.
Okay. And same ruling. I'll allow it and for this hearing and consider it's how appropriate it is to the motion.
And finally, Your Honor, exhibit number 51 is a letter dated December 23rd by Tracy Mullis, the current public defender in the Cordele Circuit, and it has attached to it her budget request for the year that she is writing about here.
Okay.
That's good. Be admitted right. As well. Beyond that, Your Honor.
No objection to that. So 51 is also admitted. So just so we're all clear, 49, 50, and 51 are admitted for the purposes of this hearing. All right.
Beyond that, Your Honor, as I said, we previously have filed with the courts all the depositions that were taken, within the time frame the court gave us. We'd ask that they all be admitted and considered.
Yes, they're all in the record, yes. In fact, I've read through several of them already.
And we also separately introduced all the exhibits that go with those depositions. As I said, they're numbered right through now 51. We'd ask all of them be admitted and considered as well.
Okay, they will be.
All right, thank you very much. Your Honor, I thought I would start off just sort of framing up what the issues are, talking just a little bit about each one. I know Your Honor hasn't looked at this case for a little while. I just want to take a quick minute to point out where the case is coming from.
Okay.
This is the Cordele Judicial Circuit made up of Chris, Ben Hill, Dooley, and Wilcox counties. It has four superior courts, of course, one in each county, but three superior court judges. Four juvenile courts, 1,700 total public defender cases, three public defenders, which averages out to 567 cases per public defender, and then one investigator. The office only represented 43 children in juvenile court last year. Had it represented, juvenile court usually has 500, 600 children, so obviously the caseload would have been much more if there had been representation of juveniles, but that's obviously not possible with just three lawyers with those kinds of caseload. And finally, Your Honor, as you mentioned before at a previous hearing, it's the only judicial circuit in which the counties do not provide any funding for the public defender office, for positions in the public defender office. At one time, there were two lawyers funded by the counties, but that is no longer the case. And that's what brings us really to the issues that we have to decide here. First of all, the first question is going to be whether the public defender is failing to provide the services of counsel to detain people within three business days of detention and application. Our argument on this is very simple. Counsel means counsel. It's not complicated. Second issue, whether the public defender has established a juvenile division. I don't think there's any doubt it hadn't until December, that specializes in the defense of children to carry out its responsibility under the statute, the Innocent Defense Act, which is to represent children in certain classes of cases that come before the juvenile court. Again, our argument on this can be summarized very simply, is that specialization means specialization. For the most part, in the last 6 years, the public defenders represented less than 10% of the children. It did not have a juvenile division until last month, Your Honor, until one was hastily created with a part-time contract lawyer who's only under contract until June 30th of this year and has no training experience and expertise in representing people and children in juvenile court. In our view, that's not specialization. That's just whoever happened to be standing around at the moment. And as I said, our argument is specialization when someone looks for a specialist, they look for more than what we have here. here's the statute. The first one that we're relying upon, Jordan, and I'll put up on the board as well, but the emphasis there, Your Honor, on counsel, that the services of counsel begin not more than 3 business days. This is a somewhat watered-down provision, Judge, from the original Indigent Defense Act, which said that counsel, services of counsel, were to begin as soon as feasible and no more than 72 hours. It was amended in 1988 to say as soon as feasible was removed from it. No more than 72 hours was changed to 3 business days, allowing even more time for a person to spend in jail before they saw a lawyer. And the makes application for counsel was added, that the person had to be arrested, detained, and make application for counsel, which can be sort of a catch-22 unless someone comes to help the person fill out the application. But that's not a problem in this particular case. The real issue, Your Honor, is whether counsel is satisfied by just sitting anybody, administrative assistant, investigator, whatever, to interview people, or whether counsel means counsel, means a lawyer. And I would submit, Your Honor, that when the Sixth Amendment of the Constitution talks about counsel, the right to a counsel, to assist you, it's talking about a lawyer. It's not talking about an administrative assistant or some investigator. It's saying that a person who is accused for crime, who as Hugo Black said in Gideon versus Wainwright, is hauled into court and charged with a crime, is entitled to the guiding hand of counsel at every step in the proceeding against him. Counsel is used in Gideon, it's used in Powell versus Alabama, it's used in thousands of cases or more over and over again, and it clearly, in all of those cases, means the right to a lawyer. Similarly, the Georgia Constitution provides that every person who is accused of a crime is entitled to the benefit of counsel. That means a lawyer. Reading any of these provisions and cases makes it clear that that's what we're talking about. But in the Cordele Circuit, a person who is accused of a crime and thrown in jail does not get that. I want you to just use one case, Your Honor, as an example here, if I could. This is a man named Eric Wyatt. He's detained on March 21st of this year, or last year, 2014, in the Ben Hill County Jail. On a 2011 warrant, Your Honor, that accused him of theft by taking, that is, borrowing a pickup truck and not returning it when he said he would. The only problem was he had already been arrested for that crime and he had already served time for that crime. But served 179 days. 21 days after he's detained, April 11th, not 3 days, 21 days, but it's unusual. I will concede that. He meets an investigator who completes the application, but that is all. 13 days after that, he meets an assistant public defender who's there just to see him about a bond hearing on May the 1st. He tells him, I've already been convicted of this crime, I've already served time for this crime, but doesn't seem to be in the interest there, maybe because of volume. Whatever reason, bond is set on May 1st at $20,000, Your Honor. And then he waits another 60 days until he comes to arraignment on June 30th. And on the morning of arraignment, he's brought over from jail, and he's put in the grand jury room where the people that have been brought over from jail are put. And another lawyer who's in the public defender office tells him he's got a deal for him, 20 years, 10 to serve. Not surprisingly, Mr. Wyatt declines. 8 days later, the district attorney now processes a case, and Mr. Wyatt is freed from the Ben Hill County Jail. 2 weeks later, the public defenders find out that their client's no longer in jail because the prosecutor dismissed the case. And this is a case where, had a lawyer seen him within 3 business days, had a person learned in the law who knew anything about the practice of law, had met him and found out that he'd already served the time, that all he had to do, in fact, Mr. Wyatt had the papers with him, that he could have been out in 3 days. Instead, Your Honor, he spends 110 days in jail for a crime that is ultimately dismissed by the district attorney because there's no crime there. And that's why people, when they get arrested and they want a lawyer, they want a lawyer. This is similar, and it has some constitutional aspects to it because it's not that different from Rothgary versus Gillespie County, the Supreme Court case out of 2008. This is a failure to provide counsel promptly to Mr. Rothgary, accused of a crime in Gillespie County, Texas. Turned out once he got a lawyer, just like in Mr. Wyatt's case, once he got a lawyer, the lawyer checked it out, found out there was nothing there, called the DA, and the case is dismissed, just like that. So he files a civil lawsuit and sues saying, because I wasn't provided counsel in a timely way, I ended up spending all this time in jail when I would have been out. In footnote 14 of that opinion, the Supreme Court points out the federal government in 43 states, and it includes Georgia, citing the statute, promptly provide counsel to people who are arrested. So I think that's some constitutional ramifications of this rule. The Georgia legislature chose to implement it in maybe the most slack way by giving 3 business days, but nonetheless it serves its purpose and prevents counties from being sued for people staying in jail because they weren't provided lawyers. Eric Wyatt's treatment, Your Honor, is not, I mean, Your Honor knows, and here in Fulton County, you get a lawyer the next day. I mean, you're arrested within 24 hours, you get a lawyer, and that's true in courts all over this country. But Mr. Wyatt's treatment, in all the depositions we took, Judge, and the exhibits and the affidavits that are before you, basically summarized as this. Person's arrested. They're usually seen within 3 days by an investigator or administrative assistants, and sometimes if, like, they fired the investigator with a text message back in September, so sometimes the lawyers will fill in. But basically, a person does not see a lawyer for weeks or even months, and I think that's important in looking at the 3 days. Why you would want to talk to a lawyer within those 3 days. All the public defenders testified that the next time a person sees a lawyer is when there is a triggering event. And what they said is that's usually a bond hearing, that is a bond that has to be set by a Superior Court judge, so that when the bond hearing is coming up, the public defender may go over the night before or go over the morning before the bond hearing and arraign them. That account is over and over and over again in the affidavits of testimony. At that point, they see a public defender, but generally to get a plea offer. I mean, this is a minimum plea in jurisdiction, and generally, like Mr. Wyatt, you come to court, and your public defender doesn't really discuss anything about your case, whether there were statements taken, whether searches and seizures, or anything like that. They say, here's what the plea offer is, expires today, you'll serve 40 years if you don't take it, so take it or leave it. So actually, a person like Mr. Wyatt doesn't really get the services of counsel at all. What it boils down to. Now, that's a larger issue for down the road in this case, not the three-day rule. But I just want to mention it. And I submit, Your Honor, so the question comes down to this. Whether somebody performing the clerical task of filling out this form, that's the position that's being taken by opposing counsel, constitutes the services of counsel under that. We contend that it isn't. That it can't be, whatever it is, it's not the services of counsel. Counsel means a lawyer, a person who's arrested, is going to have information, is going to have questions, and they want to share that with a lawyer. I mean, if you tell somebody that, you know, my friend's at work, they think I'm stealing something, I think I might get charged with embezzlement. Person will probably say, you need counsel. They don't mean an administrative assistant or an investigator. They mean a lawyer. I mean, better maybe go see Ed Garland or somebody. about your situation. Because a lawyer is going to want to know a lot about, first of all, bail, community ties, those kinds of things that here in Fulton County in the hearings that take place would possibly get somebody out, get them back to work, get them back to the family, so they could go on with their life, because many of these charges are very, very, very minor charges. They want to know about statements to law enforcement. They want to know about searches, they want to know about seizures, they want to know about any identification procedures, if any took place, and all kinds of other facts that may have legal significance that a lawyer knows has legal significance, but a layperson does not know has legal significance. And secondly, clients have questions for their lawyers. What am I charged with? What are the elements of the charges? What kind of time am I facing? What are my chances of being released on bond? How long until I'm going to have a hearing or can you suppress the statements that we're giving? All kinds of questions like that. Of course, an investigator and an administrative assistant can't answer those questions, because they're not lawyers, they're not admitted to the practice of law, and that would be practicing law without a license. In fact, the investigator, when he testified, Your Honor, said this: first thing I tell them is that I can't give them any legal advice, I'm an investigator. A client may have confidential information, the only ones to share with the lawyer. Client may want to tell things to the lawyer, to the client, based upon things that you don't know until you see the client firsthand, whether they've got mental problems, whether they're on drugs, whether they're intellectually disabled. I mean, all sorts of factors, which of course the investigator can't know what those factors are going to be and how to respond to them. The lawyer's going to do that based upon a lot of understanding of the legal significance of those things. And there's an urgency to all this. Being arrested is a big deal. Being arrested and thrown in jail, it may be that we don't think it's a big deal for poor people, but I would submit, Your Honor, it's a big deal for anybody. That most people, the average person, if they're grabbed by the nap of the neck and told they're going to be thrown in the Fulton County Jail, they want a lawyer because they want out. And they want a lawyer right now. They don't want a lawyer 6 months from now. They want a lawyer right now. And that's what we're saying folks are entitled to hear. Now, I just want to talk about this form for a minute, because what's suggested is that the investigator can just fill out a form, and that's good enough. And I'll just show it to you real quick, Judge. Here's the first page, which you can't really see, but all it is financial information. This is the first two pages are about eligibility. You can see on the second page, do you have a copy of the...
Is it a copy of the presentation?
Yeah. Okay, we have a copy if you'd like to follow on paper. But anyway, basically, as you can see, Judge, this is where they tell the person you got to pay $50, and you swear that if you don't pay and all that, what the consequences are. The significant, and then the next page is just simply the page that tells whether you're eligible or not for a public defender. So that's just totally an administrative page. So the only ones that really have anything to do with legal representation is the next page is the first of two pages called the supplemental questionnaire. One of the questions highlighted there is bond question. It only asks, do you have any witnesses for a bond hearing? Nothing at all, Judge, about the factors relevant to a bond consideration: risk of flight, danger to a person, community, property. Now, have you ever committed risk of committing a felony, intimidating witnesses? I mean, a lawyer is going to want to know about community ties, about employment, about family, about church. Is there a chance we can get grandma down here to try to help get you out? Can we get the minister down from the church to promise that he'll get you back to court if need be? Those kinds of things. And a lot of times, you not only need to know who those people are, but you need to know how to get hold of them, who to call, and what numbers, and so forth. That's not there. The second page provides space for name and address of five witnesses. Whether or not you even want to ask about that before anything else is highly questionable and probably not good practice. But And of course, it would depend a lot on the condition of the client and things like that, but it doesn't even contain a description of what the witness can tell. It's really valueless. It just has name, address, and phone number without any annotations beyond that, and generally they're not filled in beyond that. And then a big space there at the bottom, description of what happened. Basically, tell us what happened. Nothing about searches, nothing about seizures, police practices, prior relation with the victim. You think at least they'd say, were they co-defendants? Because you're going to be looking out for conflicts if formal advisory opinion 10.1, if you take it seriously, which hopefully the public defenders do by now. So I want to make it clear, the problem's not the form, the problem is not having a lawyer there. Now they say that now, once these forms are filled out, they just started this practice last month, Judge, of having one of the two assistant public defenders look at these forms and look at the file with these pages that I've just shown you in it. You can't make any assessment of a case based on that. I mean, the lawyer doesn't know whether to file a motion to suppress statements because you don't know if any statements have been made. You don't know whether there have been any searches. You really know virtually nothing based on this. So apparently what they do is decide to have preliminary hearings, which is a good thing to have. They didn't have preliminary hearings for years down there because of their understaffing. So I certainly am all for having preliminary hearings, but there's a whole lot, if you're going to have client-specific representation like you see every day in this courtroom, you've got to know more information than just what some investigator writes down about, you know, what happened. I want to make just crystal clear, Judge, that we're not talking about what the lawyer does, how the lawyer acts. The Attorney General's office has said all this about we want them to do it our way, we want you to manage how they work. No, none of that. We're just saying you get a lawyer. The lawyer does whatever he or she does based on their professional skill, knowledge, and so forth. Not asking anything about it. Not asking what the lawyer does, not about tactics, not about strategy, not about anything else, but you have a right when you're busted and when you're in jail to talk to a lawyer. That's it. And we put in an affidavit for your honor. It's also appended to the memo that we did for you that I think is pretty helpful by Russell Gabriel, who's been a public defender both in federal court and state court, who ran the public defender office in Athens for about 10 years. And his conclusion is that the information obtained on this form is so rudimentary as to be valueless, which is basically what I just said, and that whatever the services of counsel may mean, it certainly doesn't mean some non-lawyer taking down this sort of very basic information. So that's what I have to say about the right to counsel. Let me go to the second issue, which are these statutes, Your Honor, and obviously they pretty much blend together, because if the public defender is going to do what the second statute requires, which is provide representation to juveniles, it needs a juvenile division, and it needs lawyers who know how to represent juveniles, how to represent children. I didn't think that was a radical proposition, but apparently it is. But anyway, the question we have here is, can a public defender office that has gone basically without a juvenile division for ever since 2009, when the county defunded any county positions there, and has not represented more than a handful of juveniles in any one year since 2009, and we'll show you that on a chart in a moment, can you suddenly have a juvenile division by contracting on a temporary basis with a lawyer who has no experience, knowledge of juvenile representation? Can you just call that person the juvenile division and suddenly, magically, he becomes the juvenile division? Our position is no. Specialization means specialization. I'll take you just real quickly, Judge, through how we got to this point in life. In 2009, when it was clear the county had already defunded one position and was about to defund the second and only other attorney position. The public defender writes a letter to all the county commissioners and says basically that without this attorney, the office cannot adequately represent juvenile defendants. That turned out to be a very accurate prediction. Also said that without the county paid public defender, the office would cease to function in a manner that would be adequate to handle the cases at hand. This would be repeated over the years to no avail. Counties took away the position in 2009. Excuse me. Public defender comes back. He's got a letter here in 2012 where he says, we now got 1,200 new cases that we're closing a year and we're understaffed. He says he's got no, he said there's no county paid position in the office and that in order for the public defender office to function as it's supposed to, they have to have that county position that they don't have. Same thing the next year, Your Honor, once again writes and says the office is open. Now 1,600 new cases. The caseload's going up, but these three public defenders aren't changing. There are only three to handle ever-increasing number of cases, and of course that doesn't include the children. He says there's no county paid assistant, tells them that once again, and tells them once again that for the office to function, it has to have these county paid positions. Does no good. No funding by the county. Last summer, last June 25th, he wrote an email to the Public Defender Standards Council, to somebody there, again, trying to do something about the fact that the children weren't being represented. I wanted to see if there's any chance we could get a part-time contract defender. The state had provided that once before. And then he asked, where do we stand with regard to juvenile? Obviously, there have been some discussion of a juvenile attorney, but nothing had come of it. And he repeats what we already know, that the counties have been denying his request for a public defender. So that appeal gets nowhere. August 1st, Mr. Baker takes over as the interim public defender, and he writes the county attorney on August 22nd, and he said, our kids are getting shafted in juvenile court. The public defender desperately needs an attorney for juvenile cases. And then Ms. Mullis, when she becomes the public defender and has conferred with Mr. Baker about this and seen this situation, she presents the exhibit that we introduced just a few moments ago, Your Honor, in which she writes the county commissioners and said, we're requesting three personnel positions, two assistant public defenders, and an investigator, due to the lack of adequate staff, and repeats what's been told over and over again that they're understaffed. And here's what you see, Your Honor, in terms of the cases. I mean, in 2013, they had only 4% of all the juvenile cases that came before the court. Last year they handled 43. Basically they've been before, they've been right about 9%, 9.18%. There's been no representation of most of the juveniles who come before the four juvenile courts in that circuit. The Attorney General says that the contract lawyer is sufficient because he's been designated by the public defender, by Ms. Mullis. That she says, you are, this young man, by the way, Judge, whose uncle knew Mr. Baker and called Mr. Baker and said, I have a nephew and I don't mean to disparage this young man in the slightest. I'm sure he's a good, decent, fine young man, graduated from the University of Georgia. 4 years out of law school, he doesn't have a job, and his uncle calls the public defender and says, can he come over and just intern with you, just follow you around? And so he does that for a little while, and then they sign a contract with him to work 30 hours a week for $45,000, but only until June the 30th of this year. He was not interviewed or brought on to do juvenile cases. It was just that Ms. Mullis, after she took over, realized in January that they could not represent the children with the three lawyers they had because they're just so busy in Superior Court dealing with all the Superior Court cases. They're carrying 500 some odd cases apiece. When the Superior Court meets, got everybody on there at court to meet people and tell them what their plea offers are and stand by them while they plead guilty. The truth is, this is not a specialist. When we talk about a specialist, we're talking about a certain amount of education, specialized training, experience, knowledge. I mean, when we talk about a specialist in medical malpractice, I think that means something. When we talk about a specialty in bankruptcy case, or a specialist in securities law, I don't think I can just say this lawyer is a specialist in securities law because all he or she's going to do from now on is securities law. Doesn't know any securities law. Never heard of a Supreme Court case on securities, but she's a specialist now because that's all she does. I think when a potential, we think these people know more about medical malpractice or bankruptcy or whatever it may be, international transactions, security. I mean, when Delta, Coca-Cola, Home Depot, when they are looking for a specialist in commercial law, they're looking for someone who knows something about commercial law. You can't just designate somebody and say it's an expert in commercial law, go off and represent Coca-Cola in some huge thing. And our children shouldn't be treated any less. We shouldn't say that it's a specialization in commercial law if Coca-Cola wants somebody to be their lawyer, but a child can be represented by anybody. Anybody. I mean, this is the juvenile division. No training, not even a course in law school, Your Honor, on juvenile law. No training in child or adolescent development. Not aware of in-rate golf. Now, the state says, well, this is a pop quiz. But I think if you're interviewing somebody to be a public defender, and you ask them, have you ever heard of Gideon versus Wainwright? And they say, no. You might bring in the next applicant, you know, and interview them. And if you're doing juvenile law, and you've never heard of in-rate golf, of course, this wasn't an interview. This was just who happened to be around. That's the only reason this young man was made. It wasn't because he knew anything about juvenile law. It was just because he was handy. He had not read the juvenile code, not read the delinquency part of the juvenile code. He had not visited, this was in really 10 couple of weeks ago, the youth development campus and detention centers. One is right there in Crisp County. And he had not advocated for alternatives, at least in one instance that we asked him about, because he didn't know about them. Said he hadn't advocated for the balance and restorative justice program at the Department of Juvenile Justice. He didn't know it existed. So that puts children at somewhat of a disadvantage. So here's what's happening in the juvenile cases, Your Honor, and I won't go through them, but just meets on December 9th with a child, admits sentence. December 23rd is the sentencing. Most of the time, though, December 9th to 23rd, there are more cases, January 27th. In all these cases, he's literally meeting the kids in juvenile court, not going to see them outside of court. Admitting to the charges and having the person sentenced. That can't possibly be legal representation. You cannot represent somebody talking to him 15 minutes and having them admit. He said in his deposition 10 or 15 minutes he talked. It is just an abuse of the English language to call that specialization. The Georgia bar would not let him hold himself out as a specialist. You also have, judge, in the materials and appended to the memo is Linda Pace. Here's a specialist, Your Honor. This is a woman who's devoted her life to representing children. Has been the juvenile defender, just retired, but was the head of the juvenile division in the Stone Mountain Circuit for 22 years. Do the same thing 22 years, you learn some things, and she tells us that the children see, experience, understand things differently than adults. Every parent knows already that pre-teenager's brain is different than adolescents, and both are different from adults. That attorneys representing children have to have knowledge of this and the high incidence of mental disability that they may find. That they've got to know the medications that children are being given these days for attention deficit disorder and other kinds of things like that. And she says an attorney who lets a client, a child, admit at the first hearing has not provided any representation to the client. It's like having no representation at all. She talked about, and there's also an affidavit from Randy Waldman, Your Honor, at the Barton Center on Child Representation at Emory, about all of the training opportunities and so forth that are available. That what lawyers in Georgia, what public defenders in Georgia have been doing, in many public defender offices, is learning from things like the National Juvenile Defender Center about, as they say there on their publication, juvenile defense is a specialized practice. And there have been people like Sharon Hill, the former juvenile court judge here, and Linda Pace and others, who have developed this knowledge and expertise. The Supreme Court has recognized this in its opinions about children, about adolescent development. And this describes, you know, the need for specialization and that attorneys must specialize in juvenile defense. I just say this, Judge. This is the future. It's not just the future, it's now. It's been now in DeKalb County for 22 years. But it's the future. And to have the Georgia Public Defender Standards Council, the organization responsible for the poor people accused of crimes and the poor children, come in here and say that instead of having a specialist, that any lawyer is good enough for children, that any person locked up can just languish in jail until some lawyer gets around to see you. It's an absolute disgrace. It's not unusual for the Public Defender Standards Council to be taking a position contrary to its clients, but it's happened again, and what they should be making is the argument not that we go back to the past, but that we embrace the future, that we do what the Georgia legislature saw as the right thing to do when it passed its law, and see that children are properly represented when they come into juvenile court. So just to summarize, Your Honor, we think mandamus relief is warranted. They have clear duties in these two areas. They must provide lawyers. They must provide juvenile representation in these cases. No alternative remedy exists. And we would ask, Your Honor, to issue writ mandamus, ordering that an attorney be provided to meet with detained clients within 3 business days. And we would ask that the Your Honor, issue a writ mandamus requiring that the Cordele Circuit Public Defender establish a juvenile division to specialize in the defense of juveniles and our children in this state. Georgia's children are a precious thing. It's our future, and they're entitled to be represented by more than just what's going on there. Thank you.
Let me ask you a question. Sure. On that first point with regard to the mandamus relief, let me just make sure, who are you specifically asking that I order?
The public defender.
The
Now, other people may be ultimately responsible for making it happen. You know, when a court orders the warden of a prison to do something, the warden usually can't do it, or the chief jailer out here at Fulton County Jail, that person usually can't do it by themselves. They have to have the support. I know a little bit about the Fulton County Jail. I can tell you that the orders, which are directed at the sheriff and which are directed at the chief jailer, you know, the Fulton County Commission has to worry about those orders because
they have to make reality out of whatever the Constitution requires. And the same thing is here. But here, the duty is clearly set out in the statute of what the public defender must do. And it's that they must provide services of counsel within 3 days, and they must set up this juvenile division.
So that would be the circuit public defender?
Yes, the circuit public defender, Tracy Mullis.
Okay.
Circuit public defender for the Cordele Judicial Circuit.
Okay. When you deposed Ms. Mullis, did you ask her, or maybe don't think it's relevant, but was it asked where they came up with the money to hire the contract attorney?
Yes, actually that did come up, and it was discussed in several several depositions. Excuse me, just a minute. Sorry, my apologies.
No problem.
In several depositions, what happens is that for whatever reasons, every year, the public defender gives back money to the counties, despite being operating on an inadequate budget and not having enough staff. This year, they convinced the counties to let them keep that money. So this is county money, the $45,000, that enabled them to change this young intern from being an intern into a contract lawyer. $45,000, no benefits, you know, no nothing. This is like being paid, you know, $25,000 when you get right down to it. And most people that have a contract, I've found, are usually keeping an eye out for a job that has benefits. So whether or not that person will even be there to the end of June is up for grabs, but there's absolutely no provision there, Your Honor, for providing lawyers in juvenile court or having a juvenile division after this contract expires at the end of June. At least no testimony was offered by Ms. Mullis or anyone else in that regard, and the defendants didn't put on any evidence in that regard during the time we were taking evidence in this case.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, Your Honor.
All right. Let me hear from the, I guess, logically, the state defendants, Mr. Lightcap.
Thank you, Judge. I have the pleasure to represent the state of Georgia, Governor Deal, the Georgia Public Defender Standards Council, the members of that council, but I'm glad that you posed the first question when Mr. Bright's presentation was over, because we need to make sure who is actually subject to mandamus. And the state would agree that the duties, if there are any, in 17-12-23 apply to the circuit public defender, because that's who is mentioned in that statute. Not Governor Deal, because he has a constitutional duty to take care that the laws are faithfully executed. If that were the case, then Governor Deal would be a top party in any lawsuit against a public official, and I guess including your own, a lawsuit that you would be a party to, Your Honor. But at a fundamental point, this case is not about enforcing public duties. That's what mandamus requires. This case is about imposing plaintiffs' preferred public policy choices. It's about legislating through lawsuit. Mandamus is a very specific and extraordinary remedy. It's called an extraordinary remedy because it is that. It, in the case law, the statutes in the case law show that it is a very specific formula to provide relief. First, there must be a clear legal duty, one that is mandated by law or implied therein. The plaintiff must have a clear legal right. And here's some other important things about how mandamus sort of breaks down in the case law. Mandamus can't undo past acts. Whatever happened to Mr. Wyatt, who Mr. Bright talked about, that happened in the past. No mandamus order can affect that situation. It's a prospective remedy. As such, anything also that happened in the past would be irrelevant, because the question before this court is the circuit public defender presently, is the circuit public defender presently refusing to perform a duty prescribed by law? What happened in 2013, which by the way is the last date that the plaintiffs have statistics, that's almost 2 years ago.
Well, so, I think he gave it 2014 as well, verbally. I don't think it was on his chart. But.
Okay, well.
It's on the chart.
Okay.
2 months ago.
So there are two types of duties that mandamus, that public officials must perform. The first would be a ministerial duty, one that doesn't require any type of exercise of judgment or deliberation. For example, Your Honor must transmit a written order, must memorialize a written order from a ruling from the bench. That is an absolute duty that you must do in every one of your cases. And if you were sued and you were served with a lawsuit, and after you were served and the litigation had proceeded for not transmitting a written order, and then at a date certain you transmit a written order, the mandamus case is moot. That's because mandamus will not lie to provide relief that would be nugatory or fruitless. When the act required by the mandamus lawsuit is done, the mandamus case must be dismissed. Discretionary acts are a little bit different than ministerial acts, and I talked about this in my brief a little bit. The first, and I think it's important to point the court to a 2014 case, Bibb versus Monroe County, 294 Georgia 730, and I'm reading from the Penn site of 736. When the act required by law to be done involves the exercise of some degree of official discretion and judgment upon the part of the officer charged with this performance, the writ of mandamus may properly command him to act, or, as it is otherwise expressed, may set him in motion. It will not further control or interfere with his action, nor will it direct him to act in any specific manner. Goes down. Thus, mandamus is proper to compel the undertaking of some official action to which the petitioner has a clear legal right, but it is not proper either to prescribe how the action is taken or to preordain its result. Now, plaintiffs have premised their case on three duties found in 17.12.23. The first is the three-day rule, as plaintiffs call it. And each one of plaintiffs' claims fail on the facts and the law. Plaintiffs keep on saying that 17.12.23b says that the public defender shall provide services of counsel within three business days. That's not what the statute says. It says entitlement to service of counsel begins not more than three business days. Mandamus, as we talked about, requires a clear legal duty. Plaintiffs say entitlement to services of counsel means that an attorney must meet with a client within three business days. Now, if that were the case, wouldn't the statute have read, the attorney must meet with the client within three business days? That would be clear. Instead, what we're doing is we're allowing plaintiffs to impose their public policy choice on what they think is best practices on a statute that doesn't say what they say it does. And that also comes down to, the plaintiffs mentioned the Sixth Amendment. Now, you know as well as I do, Your Honor, that the Sixth Amendment does not impose mechanical rules, nor does it exist to improve the representation of indigents. It is simply a base minimum to ensure the basic fairness of proceedings. And Georgia courts, and these cases are cited in my brief for opposing class certification on pages 34 and onwards, that Georgia courts routinely, when it comes to looking at the deficiency prong of Strickland, routinely say there's no magic amount of time which counsel must spend in actual conference with his client. And we have a string cite there. Furthermore, there's a case, and I'm sure I could find others, but there's a case out of the federal court in the Central District of California. That's Amdor versus Hickman. It's cited in my class cert brief, but I'll give it to you. It's 2010 U.S. District Court, Lexis 101-308 at page 38 from the Central District of California, August 10, 2010, which says looking at a deficiency analysis under the first prong of Strickland, it is not per se deficient to have an investigator interview a client. And so when we talk about what the Sixth Amendment requires or what this Georgia statute requires, let's actually look at what courts have determined the Sixth Amendment requires, because every one of plaintiff's cases is based on one sentence. And it's like they're trying to drop a footnote under every statutory phrase. Entitlement to service of counsel means what I say it does. Representation means what I say it does. Juvenile division means what I say it does. When you're looking at a specific lawsuit like mandamus, you have to see what the law requires. not what public policy choices might be best. So, about discretionary acts. Defense lawyering is by nature discretionary. And that means that, we'll back up. Mandamus will lie to compel an official's wrongful inaction under two circumstances. One, if the official is refusing to perform a ministerial duty. The other is the refusal of the public official to perform a duty to which he has discretion to do or not. And the analysis for mandamusing a discretionary duty is the public official must have committed a gross abuse of discretion. Now, the case law that we've cited in our brief that discusses what a gross abuse of discretion is that this court would have to find that the CPD is acting arbitrarily, capriciously, and unreasonably in determining that the in performing the duties outlined by this statute. Now, that's just a very high burden and one that plaintiffs have not met. About the juvenile division, plaintiffs have conceded the juvenile division exists. David Rigdon is the head of the juvenile division, and his depositions show, all the transcripts are cited in my pre-hearing brief, that he meets with every juvenile that comes to court on a juvenile calendar. He determines whether they are eligible, and he represents them. He also gets notified by the court under any type of situation where you have a extraordinary detention hearing. So he comes to the extraordinary detention hearings and represents his clients. On the day of his deposition, that very morning, he had an indigent child released from detention, and he had some charges dismissed for another. This is effective assistance. But let's talk about what specialization means under the statute. Plaintiffs say that David Rigdon has to be an expert, and they point to expert testimony of facts or of expert opinion on what a statute means. Never really heard of that done, because in Georgia we look at the plain meaning of the statute, and that requires us to look at what specialized means. David Rigdon, his chief responsibility in the Circuit Public Defender's Office is to represent juveniles. Now, it is true that he represents some other cases in Superior Court, but in his deposition he says his main responsibility is juvenile work. Now, specialization can also mean, and we cited this in our brief, that someone's concentrating on a particular service or concentrating on a particular product. That's exactly what Mr. Rigdon does. Again, plaintiffs are trying to drop a footnote that says specialization means what I think it does. That's not in the statute. Now, it would be interesting to show that Mr. Rigdon has the qualifications by statute to be circuit public defender. This statute talks about what qualifications are required under the different officials in the statute. In 1712.21, the qualifications for circuit public defender, that's Tracy Mullis's job, are that you have to be 25 years old, David Rigdon's 31. You have to be admitted for 3 years, David Rigdon was admitted in 2010. And you have to be in good standing with the Georgia bar. Now there's a fourth requirement in that statute, and that is if you're disbarred, you have to be reinstated under good standing. So if David Rigdon by statute is qualified to be circuit public defender, the juvenile division's boss, then where are we finding the statutory mandate that specialization means that he has to know what the case name of In Re Galt is, or he has to read the entire juvenile code? It's simply not there. Frankly, I've not read the entire Civil Practice Act, but here I am practicing law before you. We're not going to impose these mechanical duties on Mr. Rigdon that are not found anywhere in statute. Plaintiffs also make some make some hay about how Mr. Rigdon's a contract employer or contract employee. There's nothing in the statute that says he can't do that. There has to be a clear legal duty for mandamus. Where's the clear legal duty that the public, that the head of the juvenile division has to be a full-time employee? They also say maybe he doesn't get re-upped. Maybe he doesn't get rehired when his contract's over. Well, there's a statute for that under mandamus too. 9626, mandamus will not lie on mere suspicion or fear. Hadn't happened yet. It's a mere suspicion or fear, so that's wholly irrelevant. Again, what we're seeing is that they're legislating by lawsuit. They're trying to impose their policy preferences where the law does not require those same preferences. This is a very specific type of lawsuit. There must be a clear legal duty. There must be a clear legal right. They have not shown that any legal duty, such as it exists, is being underperformed. Now, going back to the entitlement to services of counsel, we should look at statutes in peri materia. We should look at them in the context of the statute that they, each code section under the context of the statute that they comprise as part of a whole. The juvenile division provision says there shall be a juvenile division. That's it, absolute duty. But the creating of the juvenile division involves some amount of discretion. It doesn't say these are the factors that are relevant. It doesn't say that you can't hire somebody who clerked for a Superior Court judge in Tipp County who's friends with Bert Baker. That's not what the statute says. So they sort of try to muddy the water with irrelevant criteria and irrelevant facts that are nowhere found in the statute. Compare shall establish a juvenile division with entitlement to services of counsel begins. If the General Assembly had wanted to make an absolute duty to provide services of counsel, like plaintiffs say that the statute says, wouldn't they have said shall, like they did just one sentence later? Again, clear legal duty. Where is the clear legal duty? The state would actually agree that the representation of juveniles is a legal duty that the CPD must do, as is creating the juvenile division. But representation and choosing who to hire as the juvenile division requires an amount of discretion. And again, mandamus law is clear. No court can tell an official how to exercise their discretion. They can only say, get the ball rolling. That's that Bibb versus Monroe County case that I talked about at the beginning of my presentation. And so, I think I've talked about the so-called three-day rule in the juvenile division. I need to talk a little bit about the representation of juveniles. Now, the depositions in this case have plainly shown that David Rigdon goes to every juvenile calendar. He goes to the emergency detention hearings. In fact, he says no juvenile defendant has ever refused his services. So ever since he's become juvenile division, he's represented every juvenile that's come to court. So is the office representing juveniles? Absolutely. He's doing it right now. How they're represented, that's again a discretionary duty. The court cannot tell David Rigdon how to represent, because one, that's against mandamus law that would be a general course of conduct order that would require the court to oversee how he is representing his clients. But two, there are tons of cases under the Sixth Amendment context that say the courts should abstain from intensive judicial scrutiny. They should not impose mechanical rules. That every case is based on it, or every case must be judged by itself. It's a case-by-case analysis. So I want to talk a little bit about some other things that plaintiffs have brought up. One is the statistics that they bring up. They show how many cases are, they make a presentation of how many cases are disposed of in the juvenile courts of the Cordele Circuit and how many the how many cases the public defender's office had previously represented and disposed of. But those statistics from the AOC, they lump together delinquent and unruly cases, and it's not clear exactly what types of cases the AOC statistics are contemplating. And it certainly doesn't talk about whether, the statistics don't tell you whether these children were represented by someone other than the public defender, because there could have been conflict counsel or the refusal of an indigent or his or her parent, or really the indigent has the choice, but the refusal of an indigent to hire a lawyer. As I understand the juvenile code, the only time that a juvenile is required to have a lawyer and can't waive that decision would be when his or her liberty is in jeopardy. And as you know, Judge, there are tons of different things that the juvenile court can do to any juvenile defendant. They can order restitution, which doesn't implicate liberty. They can order, they can issue a warning. There's just a whole lot of things that that a juvenile court can impose on an indigent. And speaking of what the statute requires, the 17-12-23 only talks about how the CPD must represent juveniles who may encounter a disposition of probation, commitment, or confinement. So that's a statutory qualification that the plaintiff statistics do not really speak to. And what I'd like to leave you with, Your Honor, is just remember that the writ of mandamus is an extraordinary writ that can only lie where there's a clear legal duty. I've shown you, I think, how the entitlement to services of counsel is not clearly mean what plaintiffs say it does. If there's a reasonable basis by Ms. Mullis to decide that entitlement to services of counsel means that the representation is initiated by means of the interview with the investigator and the forms, as long as that's not arbitrary and capricious, it can't be displaced through mandamus. Regarding specialization, again, the juvenile division exists, so they've already conceded that their entire case is based on what specialized means. Specialized, as long as Ms. Mullis is not clearly unreasonable, arbitrary, and capricious in deciding that specialized means that Mr. Rigdon will concentrate his services on the juvenile, the representation of juveniles, which the record evidence absolutely shows he does. As long as that determination was not clearly unreasonable, arbitrary, capricious, it cannot be displaced. And furthermore, I'm not sure if mandamus can undo the appointment of David Rigdon, because there's several cases that say that mandamus will not undo past acts. So that leaves the court in a predicament of how it's going to fashion its order if it decides that the CPD has failed in any three of these regards. Mm-hmm. How would you be able to write an order that would not be the type of general course of conduct, the controlling of official discretion that mandamus absolutely does not require, does not allow? So for these reasons and the ones I put in my brief, we would ask you to deny the writ of mandamus, and I thank you for your time.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Lightcap. All right, county defendants.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Bright's presentation today, there were a couple of things missing. There's no statute up there that requires any action by any county government. There's no citation to any statute that requires any action by any county government. There was no argument regarding any county government today. In Mr. Bright's demand for or description of what relief he's seeking, it was nothing having to do with any county government or any county government official. In their petition, the plaintiff's petition, they appear to seek an order of the court requiring the four county governments of the Cordele Judicial Circuit to fund additional assistant public defenders in order to assist in the carrying out of the public defender's duty. So even though they haven't asked for that relief here today, that's what I want to address. And and there are 4 points I want to hit. The first one is the most obvious one and really the most important one. There is no legal duty to act. A writ of mandamus requires a clear legal duty or a gross abuse of discretion in carrying out a legal duty. An authorization is not enough. The Bland Farms case versus Georgia Department of Agriculture, 281 Georgia 192, says that very specifically. The mere authorization to act is not enough, is insufficient for the issuance of a writ of mandamus unless the law requires performance of the duty. So there are two statutes that govern the role counties play in indigent defense. And the first statute is OCGA section 15.6.24. And what 15.6.24 says is that counties are required to fund contingent expenses of the superior courts. That's subsection A. Subsection B says any costs incurred in providing defense services pursuant to the Georgia Indigent Defense Act of 2003 for persons accused of crimes shall not be considered contingent expenses of the superior courts for the purposes of this code section. So no duty on the counties to provide that funding. The other statute is OCGA 17-1231-A. The circuit public defender in each judicial circuit may employ additional assistant public defenders, deputy circuit public defenders, or other attorneys, investigators, etc., if the employment of such additional personnel is provided by local law or specifically authorized and funded by the governing authority of the county. That's it. Those are the only two statutes. The only two sources of legal authority that address the county's role in providing assistant public defenders in the Cordele Judicial Circuit or any judicial circuit. At most, you have an authorization, and an authorization cannot be the basis of a mandamus action. There's an analogous case, Wilson versus Sutherland, which we cite, and we address the petition for written mandamus in our motion to dismiss along with the other claims. We cite this case in there. It's 258 Georgia 479. It's a district attorney case. And in that case, the district attorney was suing the county, saying that they had defunded his money for assistant district attorneys. And the court said it doesn't matter that past boards had funded the assistant district attorney, because actions of past boards of commissioners can't bind present or future boards of commissioners. Mandamus, and the court found in that case the mandamus was improper. Then there's a problem of who the plaintiffs are. Even if the counties did owe a duty to fund the public defender's office, the plaintiffs are not the public defender's office. And when you're asking a court to order the payout of public money, the Fulton County versus State, 282 Georgia 570 says, those who demand its payment should be able to show a clear provision of law which entitles them to receive it. Our plaintiffs are not entitled to receive any money appropriated to the public defender's office. And a couple of the cases that they cite demonstrate this point exactly. The Saba case out of Doherty County, 278 Georgia 176, a sheriff sues the county, saying that he's not being appropriately funded, asking for a writ of mandamus. In the Grimsley versus Twiggs County, 249 GA 632, the clerk of Superior Court sues the county in the in asking for a writ of mandamus because she's not being appropriately funded. What do those two cases have in common? The sheriff and the clerk were the plaintiffs, the ones asking for the writ of mandamus, the ones who were entitled to, they contended, receive the public money. The plaintiffs do not even claim such an entitlement. So in the absence of a clear legal duty to act, plaintiffs argue that the counties have grossly abused their discretion. Again, even in the context of a gross abuse of discretion, it has to be a gross abuse of discretion in carrying out a duty. And here there is no duty. The public defender is a state employee. Even if the counties provided the money for additional assistant public defenders, those assistant public defenders would be state employees. This is a state agency that offers a branch under an executive agency of the state of Georgia. There is no legal duty of the county to fund it. There's also, they have provided no evidence. There's no evidence in the record. They provided no evidence of any arbitrary capricious action by the counties in their decision not to fund assistant public defenders in the court of judicial circuit. But they do say in their petition over and over again that the only way the PD can do her job appropriately is with county funds. Well, first of all, I think the state has made a very good case that that's just not the case. The PD is doing her job. They're appropriately representing defendants in the Cordele judicial circuit. But there are other sources of funding if more funding is necessary. And for instance, OCGA section 1712.27A provides that additional assistant public defenders may be provided if the money is appropriated by the General Assembly or otherwise available. It doesn't have to come from the camp. The remedy that they seek is also improper because it demands a particular outcome. And when a writ of mandamus is issued in the context of a gross abuse of discretion, the court can only order the county or the governmental body to exercise discretion. It cannot order a particular outcome. And that's what they want. They want the court to order them to appropriate the money, not to consider appropriating the money, because there's no evidence that the counties have not considered it. The Bland Farms case, which is Georgia Department of Agriculture, 281 Georgia 192, mandamus can be used to compel an official to exercise his or her discretion, but not to direct the manner in which the discretion is exercised. Georgia Department of Transportation versus Peachtree Hills Property, 278 Georgia 198. Mandamus is an appropriate remedy to enforce the performance of a public duty which a public officer neglects or refuses to perform, but it is not available to compel an act that is discretionary. In other words, mandamus can compel an official clothed with discretion to act, but it cannot mandate the outcome. Doherty County versus Webb, 256 Georgia 474, which is one of the cases cited by the plaintiffs on the gross abuse of discretion issue. The correct remedy under mandamus is to order the commission to do what the plaintiff had a clear legal right to do, consider all the evidence offered. It cannot mandate an outcome. The third point I'd like to address is in the petition, they talk about the inherent authority of the court to issue a writ of mandamus to compel an action that has to do with the orderly administration of the court. First, we would suggest that the inherent authority exists only within the court's own circuit. None of the cases that they cite are cases where a judge from another circuit has exercised any inherent authority over a different circuit. This court has no inherent authority to alter the orders of a judge from Chris County. It has an inherent authority to alter its own orders, to control its own courtroom, but not those in the Cordele Judicial Circuit. And so there is no inherent authority here. In the Fulton County versus State case that we cite in our brief also just completely flies in the face, I mean, completely shuts down any argument based on inherent authority. In that case, the judge attempted to order the Fulton County, to fund particular expenses of a particular defendant's legal services, And the Supreme Court said, no, it's not part of the contingent defenses. It's not the county's responsibility. You can't order the county to pay it. And in the Wilson versus Sutherland case, the court noted that inherent authority, that even within the context of your own circuit, of the court's own circuit, inherent authority should be exercised with caution. The final point I'd like to address, Your Honor, is separation of powers. And that really is what this petition flies in the face of. This petition asks this court to put aside the decisions of the General Assembly when it, in 2003, decided to make public indigent defense in Georgia a state problem, not a county problem, or a state duty, not a county duty. The General Assembly decided not to include the services of counsel as part of the contingent defense expenses the counties were required to pay. The General Assembly decided to authorize, not require, the county to fund additional public defenders. And then there are four other legislative bodies who have made a decision here that the plaintiffs have asked the court to undo. And those are the four boards of commissioners of those individual counties. It probably would not be a surprise to the court to know that the public defender is not the only person coming to the county asking for money. The boards of commissioners have to make these sort of decisions all the time. These are four of the poorest counties in the state of Georgia. They have a limited amount of money to appropriate. And every time they have to make a decision, is it rob Peter to pay Paul? Is it raise taxes on the citizens of the counties? Or sometimes it's to say no. And in this case, they have said no. Now, I should note, the last request by Ms. Mullis for the funding of the two public assistant public defenders and the investigator is outstanding. It hasn't been acted on. But up until now, the answer has been no. But they're not, PD's not the only one that gets told no by the commissioners. They have a lot of considerations that they have to weigh in making any appropriation. This court should decline to inject itself into the day-to-day running of the public defender's office and into the decision-making of the county commissioners.
Thank you, sir. All right, Mr. Broad. I suspect that last point is why you framed the issue, the first issue that we talked about earlier, as you did, where I would just enter an order that directs that attorney representation be provided, and then basically let the defendants figure out how they're going to fund that and comply with the order. Is that fair to say? Okay.
I think that's right, and that's why I framed it that way. I do want to thank Mr. Bingham for reminding me that we did, in the brief that we filed with Your Honor on October 28th, discuss the same cases that he was talking about as an alternative basis for the court ordering mandamus relief against the counties. But I think that's right. I think that the focus of it is it's just like a jail. You say you can't put 10 people in a cell for one. Now, how you do that, it's up to the people in charge to figure out how to solve the problem. If they're running an unconstitutional jail, I just pick up on Mr. Bingham's very last point when he says a lot of people come to the county commission. This is constitutional. The library, you know, you spend a whole lot more money in the library. I'm all for libraries. I go to the library. I love the library. I think it's great. But it's not constitutionally required. The right to counsel is constitutionally required. And obviously the people who benefit from the constitutional right, the Sixth Amendment and the Georgia constitutional right to counsel, are the poorest and most powerless people in the society. So of course, they have no, as Robert Kennedy said in 1963, the poor person accused of a crime has no lobby. The people have to do it because it's the right thing to do. Because it's not the right thing to do, it's constitutionally compelled to be done. But, yes.
Look, just for my own edification, before the Indigent Defense Act, I know the counties around the state had kind of an ad hoc system. I think there was a prior version of this Indigent Defense Act, but 20, 30 years ago, it was just kind of ad hoc based on...
Ad hoc. Each county had a tripartite committee made up of three people, one appointed by the judge, one by the local bar, and I forget who appointed the third one, and they were in charge. So it was a complete hodgepodge, 159 different system.
And so this is, may not, this probably not germane in terms of the day, but again, just for my own interest, how would an attorney then, like yourself, have enforced this constitutional obligation on a county? And who would you be seeking mandamus against in that situation before you had this? This is a separate duty, but you're also arguing there's this overall constitutional duty to provide counsel.
But what the difference is, Your Honor, is this: the statute created, these two statutes we have up for you, create a clear right under the statute in Georgia, which obviously the legislature did to implement the constitutional right to counsel. Before those statutes existed, we brought lawsuits, but they weren't based on mandamus. They were brought under 1983 based on the fact that there was a systemic violation of the right to counsel because of inadequate funding, because of a lot of things. And Ouida County, when sued, set up a public defender. Actually, Cordele was sued back in 2003. And the answer to the suit in 2003 was, we're going to set up a public defender before everybody else does. In April of 2004, and it's going to be a model public defender office for the whole state to resolve what had been happening there before, which was two contract lawyers who just met with the defendants and just met them and pled them. And so there's going to be full-time public defenders. It's going to be fully staffed 5 lawyers. There were 2 investigators. There was Sheriff Milton who specialized in juvenile representation. Now is in the Macon public defender office. But basically, this was one of several public defender offices that was created in response to litigation before passage of the act. In fact, one of the reasons I think the legislature passed the act in 2003 was, well, partly because 3 straight chief justices had said, what's going on in our courts is a disgrace, but also because they wanted to bring an end to the litigation about it and provide a system by judicial circuits, not by each county going off on its own direction, by judicial circuit as to how people were to be represented.
Okay.
Which is what most states have done, you know, long, long ago. I mean, you know, Florida, Gideon was a case out of Florida, Your Honor, came down in 1963. Within 2 months, Florida set up a public defender system in every judicial circuit. Within 2 months, the governor went to the legislature and said, we got to have a public defender. We're 40 years behind that. But other states have set up public defenders and there's different ways of doing it.
Okay. All right. Well, that adds some perspective for me. All right. Thank you.
Just to respond very briefly, Your Honor, this is not legislating through a lawsuit, as Mr. Lightcap said. The legislature already legislated. It passed 17-12-23-B and C. This is just enforcing the legislation. It's not my policy. They keep talking about my policy or our policy preferences. I guarantee you, my policy preferences are so completely different than what the Georgia Public Defender Standards Council does. We're not even the same universe, Your Honor. So there's no effort here to enforce my policy preferences. It's to enforce the policy preferences that were adopted by the legislature of the state of Georgia in 2003 and amended by the legislature, at least with regard to 17-12-23 in 2008. This is enforcement of law that already exists. It doesn't do much good for the legislature to pass a law and everyone just ignore it. At some point, you come to court and say, the legislature passed the law, you have a duty under the law, and you've got to follow your duty in that regard. Second thing I'd say, it's not about undoing anything. Obviously, we can't undo what's happened. It's tragic what's happened. It's tragic how many people stayed in jail, went off, because they were poorly represented, how many children went to court and didn't have lawyers. But we're not trying to undo the past. But the past is prologue. The past tells us where we've been. It tells us the context in which this happens, whether this is just some aberrational thing. These 4 counties are all of a sudden not funding. Only 4 counties in the whole state of Georgia. That these 4 counties, just for a year or something, are not funding their public defender office. No, no, no. They've been ever since 2009. They've been the outliers. They've been unwilling to do their constitutional duty in that regard. Well, you could write the statute differently. They said you could say shall provide counsel instead of the entitlement against. You can write it a lot of different ways. That's irrelevant. The statute clearly goes through all of the different areas in which the public defender provides a representation in felony cases and juvenile cases and so forth. And then it says in each of the actions just outlined up there in section A, entitlement begins not more than 3 business days. That's understood as that's when, in those situations, a lawyer is to be provided to people. And I think that's clearly what the legislature was talking about with regard to that. And I don't think it could be any more clear. I just say this about the reliance on Strickland, Your Honor. Strickland is not apropos here because it's a post-conviction case. Strickland is about how you measure a counsel's performance after a conviction and whether it made a difference. I mean, the Attorney General has represented the state of Georgia in getting Robert Holtzley executed, even though his lawyer was drinking a quart of vodka every day during his trial and was about to be indicted for stealing client funds and disbarred in prison. But the Georgia Supreme Court, in its wisdom, said that despite those deficiencies, there's not a substantial probability it affected the outcome. So what a court says after the fact, in terms of what difference it made, is not of any moment as to what you can do. That's sort of like claiming that if you do something, it's going to be harmless error. It may be harmless error after the fact, but it can't be harmless error before the fact. And there are a number of cases, and I'll tell you the ones that are more on point, Your Honor, and I point you to them. We cite them in our brief, Wilbur versus City of Mount Vernon, which was the case, the federal case. It was actually started in state court, but moved to federal court in Washington, in which the federal district judge held that it was appropriate to make orders with regard. It rejected the Strickland argument and a lot of other arguments and ordered that counsel be provided in the municipal courts there in two towns, one the city of Mount Vernon and another town. We also appended to our pleadings the statements that the Department of Justice filed in that case and another case, which set out the authority inside a number of other cases that I won't try to go into here. The fact that the contract lawyer goes to every hearing doesn't prove anything. Anybody can go to every hearing. I can send a high school child down there to go to every hearing. And the fact that he's qualified to be circuit public defender, he's qualified to be president of the United States. I mean, he meets the age, he meets the qualifications. So I don't know where that gets us. The fact that normally when you hire someone, you don't just look at their age, but you look at their experience, their knowledge. If you're hiring them just as a line person that you're going to bring along, then that's one thing. But if you're hiring them to take a specialized office, if they're the major crimes unit or the capital crime, if you hire somebody to do capital cases, you hope they have a little experience in capital cases. If you hire somebody to do juvenile cases, you hope that they know some of this cutting edge information, which I'm sure Your Honor is quite familiar with regard to childhood development. All these things have a tremendous impact on how children behave, and we can save a lot of these children from going off to juvenile prisons where no telling what is going to happen to them if they're adequately represented, if alternatives are found, and that's what the here in Fulton County and DeKalb County and throughout the state. I mean, Nikki Vaughn in Gainesville is the head of the, and has been for a long time, the head of the juvenile division. There's just no comparison here. And in terms of getting the ball rolling, that's all we're saying, is to get, well, here's the bottom line on this juvenile matter, Your Honor, for ever since 2009. They could advertise for a lawyer who specializes in representing children and put out that announcement and get applicants for it, and the reason they can't do it is because they don't have any money. They only have 3 positions, and they have to use those 3 positions in Superior Court. And the result is they end up with a $45,000 contract, which is a part-time person. which I'm not saying you could never do that, don't get me wrong. I'm not, that would be an absolute position that it wouldn't take. But I'm saying that here, if you, somebody said, Mr. Lycan said, we're trying to tell Mr. Reagan how to practice. We're not talking about practice. We're saying we need somebody who knows how to practice. And that person then can practice on their own. And I think, Your Honor, with regard to the comments and the arguments that my, I want to again thank Mr. Bingham for reminding me. We briefed that in our mandamus memorandum on October 28th that's filed. And we discussed those same cases that he discussed, Doherty County and Grimsley versus Twiggs County and so forth. Your Honor probably doesn't really want to hear a long argument about that right now.
Well, let me ask you one thing that I am interested okay. in, that Fulton County versus state case, the Nichols litigation, that does seem to be a strong case for the counties.
Well, but that was that was in the context of a judge with a trial before him exercising his inherent authority to order Fulton County to pay certain expenses in the case. When in fact, there's a clearly established procedure under Georgia law, Brooks versus State, that said when there was an application for funds, the application had to be made, showing had to be made, the court had to make a determination of it, not based on inherent authority, but based on the due process clause of the United States Constitution, 8 versus Oklahoma, and the Georgia Constitution, Roseboro versus State. Very different than the situation that we're in here. I mean, this is a festering sore that has gone on now since 2009. It's not something that just happened yesterday. It's something that's gone on since 2009. It's hurting children. And in a situation like that, and it's there is a constitutional imperative, but these four counties can't just decide the Constitution of the United States doesn't apply here. You know, put up a sign on I-75, Constitution Free Zone, welcome to Cordele. You can buy some dirty magazines, and it's a Constitution Free Zone, except for the First Amendment, I guess. You can't do that, Your Honor. The Constitution applies in every county in Georgia. And you can't opt out of the Constitution of the United States. And that's our argument.
All right. Well, I'll tell you, it's a fascinating case. Like that?
May I make one point about Strickland?
Sure, briefly.
None of the cases that I talk about are analyzing the prejudice prong of Strickland. Strickland has two prongs. Every case I've talked about talks about the deficiency prong, whether an attorney is acting reasonably under the Constitution. So the cases of Lucky versus Harris, which plaintiffs say Strickland is completely irrelevant to this type of case, I would agree with plaintiffs that prejudice is irrelevant to this case. But what constitutes effective performance under the Sixth Amendment should be analyzed under the first part of Strickland.
But based on the totality of counsel's representation.
Okay. All right. Well, good. I'm still going through everything, and I appreciate both sides being here and helping me clarify the issues. I've got a pretty good feel for where each of you are coming from, and I hope to get you in order shortly.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Oh, Your Honor.
Yes.
Can I ask this on dates
yes.
real quick, and I haven't really asked this of my co-counsel, but you know, we have a status hearing, which some co-counsel...
You don't need this on the record, do you?
No.
Okay.
I'll see if they change their mind, but as somebody pointed out at the time, you probably don't need it because we probably won't have anything to have a status hearing about on March 25th. But we have some deadlines for when things are due to be written and to be submitted to Your Honor. But I would submit we not have, if everybody's agreeable to this.
I'm agreeable.
Are you agreeable?
Yeah, there's no point.
There's no point in having a status hearing until after everybody's responded to the motions to dismiss and other things that are outstanding, the class action, and then we can have a status hearing and schedule some dates and all that. So I'd ask the court just to strike
okay.
the all status right. hearing all for right. March 25th.
We'll take that off then.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
And Your Honor, would post-hearing brief be at all helpful to you?
I don't think so. Not right now. Ms. Abrams and I have already been working on it, working on the order. So if we need anything, we'll be in touch.
Thank you.
Yep.
Great.
Okay.
Thanks, y'all.
Thanks so much.
It's been a pleasure talking to all of y'all. Okay.
Well, thank you.
Okay, great. Okay.
But that I can't believe.
Likewise. Here's the thing, Steve. I definitely want to discuss it too, but you know, the AG's office is a different type of breed. We don't make policy, we represent clients. So that is a
hard job. Yeah, that's not your fault. I know that. Yeah. But she represents clients. I've always thought that.
It's a weird system. That's for a new lawsuit.
Hi, how are you?
Always good to see you, man. Exactly. We should get some work. Hey, what's up, man? Good to see you, man. Nice little trip down here again. What's up, Atia?
Good. It's good to see you.
How's everything been going?
Things are good.
Good.